the day's final panel discussion on the rise and fall of PropTech in real estate. And I'd like to request our session moderator, consultant Mumbai, please come on stage. Amit is the driving force behind the steep growth of the small-time real estate broking firm to an ISO and CRISIL certified organization. Today, he manages a sales turnover of over 2,000 crores. He now commits 2019 plans to go to public issue, grow to a 500-member team, and have an office each in 30 countries. Can we have Mr. Amit Vadhwani onto the stage, please? All right, everybody, Mr. Amit Vadhwani is here. Could we give him a huge round of applause, everyone? Come on, we can do better than that. And I have. And moving on, I'd like to invite Ms. Nirupa Shankar, Executive Director of Brigade Enterprises Limited. As a second-generation entrepreneur at Brigade Group, Ms. Nirupa Shankar oversees the company's hospitality ventures. She has over 12 years of work experience in consulting, hospitality, and real estate. Five hotels. More in the pipeline. Nirupa founded the country's first, maybe even the world's first, real estate focused accelerator called the Brigade Real Estate Accelerator Program, or REAP, in October 2016. It is the first of its kind accelerator program in the world that is focused on technology in the industry. Moving on to our next panelist, please welcome Mr. Akshay Devani, CEO, Residential and Partner Assets Property Group. Akshay leads the group's residential business alongside he plays an advisory role in the other verticals of the group. His current focus is to develop and execute a robust growth strategy of residential real estate. He has played roles in the investment side of a reputed real estate fund and family offices. Please put your hands together for the next panelist, Mr. Darshan Govindraju, Director of Vaishnavi Group. Darshan Govindraju spearheads the marketing and CSR initiatives. Darshan brings ideas to the company's marketing and expansion strategies, as well as its goodwill activities. These ideas are backed with sound thinking from an international educational background and exposure. Using his international education as a starting point to better understand the functioning of the Indian realty market, Darshan is with structure into Vaishnavi brand. Please put your hands together for the next panelist, Mr. Avinash K. Gautam, CEO, Sylvan Innovation Labs Private Limited. Avinash is the founder and CEO of Sylvan Innovation Labs, one of the fastest growing companies in the area of home and enterprise automation in India. He is in India and the US and is 2 times winner of EDN Asia Component of the Year Award. Prior to founding Sylvan, Avinash headed the India Design Center of Montalvo Systems, where he set up a team of 150 engineers and managed the operations and technical execution of a complex high-performance microprocessor. R.G. Isaac Matthew, founder and managing director, TechShoe.com. R.G. Isaac is a thought leader in digital marketing. With a master's in computer and bachelor's in mathematics, he started as a high-end algorithm writer, web coder, and server optimizer. In the journey, he headed few digital marketing agencies. With 15 years of hands-on digital marketing experience, he has achieved an absolute balance of marcom, tech, business modeling, and digital know-how, which allows him to integrate core business KPI to digital marketing KPI. And lastly, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mr. Rohit Rupal, consultant. Rohit Rupal is a versatile real estate professional with a rich experience in business development and channel and direct sales, marketing, project management, collection, and retention. As Vice President Sales and Operations at Sai Estate Consultants, Rohit formulates strategies to expand customer base in line with the vision and value. He has previously been associated with Housing.com, Four Clover Realty and Latim Lifestyle and Resorts Limited in various professional capacities. Could you please put your hands together for this really fine, esteemed set of folks on the stage? And I'd like to request Mr. Vadva.
Hello. Oh, it's working. You know, when we do the mic check at on Republic Television, so if I tell you to do the mic check, how would you do the mic check?
Sai Estates.
You said Sai Estates. That's a sponsor.
Is this hearing me or not?
But when we do that on Republic Television, everybody has to say, "Hi, Arnab Goswami." That's how we do the mic check. Okay, so very good evening. It's nice to see so many people. I would like to believe that all of you have gathered because aapko pata tha ki myself elevated way I always like to feel. So how many developers in the room? Can we do a show of hands? Arre dagiye mat, record nahi hoga hai, aapse sawal nahi poochne wala hu main. So good. So I feel, you know, there was and broker friends also, because I started off as a broker and I'm proud to still be a broker and run a large brokerage firm in India which could get listed next year on the stock exchange. But that's not what we are talking this evening. What we're going to talk about is, to 2 se 3 saal pehle ye prop tech kya hai. Amit Vadhwani ko mujhe pata nahi tha ye prop tech kya hai. So my very talented vice president, who is from the B school and is an engineer and does the right thing right, and you know, I was in a t-shirt and jeans this afternoon and he had to board flight. But before I come to you, let me ask the lady, for everyone, because aise bahut log honge jinko shayad pata nahi hoga ki proptech kya hai, but because we are in the city of Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad, and it is the South Conclave, we are all IT informed. But for the camera and proptech, because real estate, most we are taking a pan India vision. Having said that, somebody who is from Chandigarh, a Sardar ji who is a developer, wants to know what is PropTech. So what is PropTech?
So technology to me is anything that can either make me build any sort of
infrastructure. So developers understand, get me more money, but usse pehle aapne kya kaha?
So you have to get more money, you have to do things faster, you have to scale up faster, and that's basically it. In the end, it's everything. I mean, anybody would invest in money only to, I mean, anybody would invest in technology, yeah, only if it helps them make more money in the end. So
technology, how is it adding value?
Makes your operations more efficient. So you have to choose which technology works for you. So we try to look at technology. Why do people use ERPs? Why do people use any sort of software? It's either, like, even if it's your marketing software, it's to see, okay, which is my relevant link. And you niche segment using technology to find the right.
So there are a few holding owners, and there is an ad, two ad agency guys that I know who meet out of Bangalore Times and Bangalore Mega, Pune Mega, and all of that.
Yeah.
So that brings me to my next question.
Yeah.
Placing an ad on Facebook for a tablet piece, the Mumbai Times or Delhi Times, which is better according to you?
You have to do both.
Which will get in, why? Why do you have to do both?
Because if you talk to, you have to do both, because I think if you're on Facebook, you may not directly be looking for a real estate ad, and neither will you be directly looking for a ad if you're. And I think it depends on what you want to do. If you want to get brand awareness, you might have to use both. If you're looking for a very specific lead generation, you might just do a very niche digital marketing campaign. But it depends on what you want to achieve. If it's brand awareness, definitely the hoardings, the ads in the newspaper will help. But if it's very niche,
I think she was spot on.
So a lot of people tell me that print, sorry, Dr. Batra is not here, but print is dying a slow death. Our magazine is also printed, but there is a digital forum also. But do you agree that print, as far as campaigns and all of that, 5 years from now, will you see a real estate elevation on the first page of a tier 1 city jacket paper?
I also believe print was dying, but then I think Times of India was pretty smart. They came up with barter. I think because of that, I think
every single day to Times of India, our text messages, magicwix.com, the newspapers are all owned by Times, but you know, do you believe that Indian developers are spending money in technology, in digital lead generation versus, because with 5 jackets, 6 jackets, 7 jackets, but still people choose to advertise?
So for us, Cynthia, just speak for myself, I think print is booster for launches. I don't think we use print to sustain a campaign or to generate leads.
Right.
I think whenever we have something which we open with or use print, otherwise I think the majority of it is consumed by digital now. So I think that print would not be dying as such, because I think, as she said, that you need brand awareness, and I think print does bring a brand awareness beyond a focused targeted crowd.
Right.
So I think if you want to build a brand, you will need print.
Right.
But I don't think it will die away as a medium.
But you know, adding on to what you said, I on a popular website, without giving the website enough mileage, a roadblock banner on digital platform is 6 lakh rupees. A Pune can be 5 lakh rupees. Do you feel that Indian advertisers from the real estate sector, and most of, I would like to, see, I am a college dropout, so I feel most of the Indian real estate developers are not as good looking as you, are not as educated as you, as digitally advanced as you, but most of the Indian developers are also evolving as to, because Baga, sir, Jaydeep bhai, you're right. Borivali, Kandivali, all the Gujarati population used to, you just have to print a flex and everything used to get sold out. But now is the era of organic, real end user sales, which is coming from where?
Demand. So if you have more supply than demand, then you need to capture more consumers.
Let me quickly, quickly get his opinion. We've been on a panel earlier as well. Aapka kya opinion is pe? And keep your business aside.
No, absolutely. See, every media has its own advantage, disadvantage. That it adds the trust and it tells you that the property has arrived. But that does not mean that it's going to give you sales from the next day. But if you do not have a follow-up campaign after that, then it's a waste. The same thing with digital. If you are doing some campaigns, but there is no follow-up, which is not about the property, but something about an event or something.
Right.
And after that, if you don't have a follow-up campaign, and people are going to buy the property when they need the property. It's
right.
Not that you can push it through Facebook. And Facebook is an impulsive media, where it's not a need-based. Like in
right.
Google, it's a need-based, but Facebook is meant to get the right people.
Right.
And also with the ads, you can filter that this ad is for you, this ad is for you, and then people can come to you. And again, it's a niche media which is available. So you can't separate one media from the other. And if you're doing a branding exercise, I will put a ratio of around 30 to 70 follow-up campaign. What happens, put all the campaigns into branding and then there's no follow-up campaign.
How many accounts do you service? How many developers do you work for?
Around close to 17, 18.
Do they pay you?
Of course.
On time?
We take advance.
So, mujhe lagta hai, I am an ape man because aapko importance. But are you sure you get paid on time?
No, absolutely.
Agar bolo ya, aapko koi nahi kahega.
Nahi, nahi, hum log advance mein lete hain, otherwise kaam nahi karte.
Super.
As simple
as that.
Sir,
we were discussing about certain technology, about home automation, about product innovation. So, all this while we've been discussing about to convince people, how to generate a lead, service the lead, CRM. But from a product standpoint, is there anything that if there is a consumer who has nothing to do with real estate and is getting bored looking at me speaking, is there anything for the consumer that the industry is doing?
Certainly. Automation or technology in the homes is one thing where you love it or hate it, but you can't ignore it, right? And to understand it well, we have to understand the ecosystem in which we work, right? Everyone is carrying a cell phone. The broadband is everywhere. There are voice assistants. People are talking about artificial intelligence. The things that you are changing, and if today's teenager becomes tomorrow's home buyer, he will want to have everything on his phone, right? So this is being understood.
There's
by
a
most
new fancy word for it.
What's that?
Millennials. Millennials.
Yeah. So certainly we are seeing a lot of real estate.
In terms of innovation, we talk about innovation. For me, I was discussing this offline with you. When I think of innovation, मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि iPad पे AC चालू होगी, बंद होगी, curtains चालू होंगे, बंद होंगे. Okay, मतलब am I outdated? Are there things that home automation or tech simple?
I mean, a very simplistic view of automation is that you are able to control all of your appliances either through, you know, your pad or your voice assistant and so on and so forth. And that was a, you know, you can say that a fancy view of things. Whether it's really needed for your survival is always questionable. But slowly as the industry is maturing, same thing in such industry as Tesla did in the car industry, the CTO of that company. And the world is changing towards actually using the same technologies, but using it in a different way to make the house more responsive to your needs, more easy to maintain, more safe, and ease of, you know, to, you know, right, lesser long-term cost of ownership of the house.
What is the cost?
Very little these days with modern, what we call as IoT, Internet of Things technology, which are very different than the traditional, you know, proprietary automation systems. And it will cost you 20, 25 rupees a square feet extra. That's
and
about
are
it.
Are all developers receptive to this?
Most of them have portions of it. They cannot expect you to
just
stop the barrel. But, you know, we are working with around 40 developers all over India, and a lot of them in Mumbai as well. And people definitely have plans around it, and they have different views about it, and people are taking measured approach towards this. I mean, all said and done, real estate projects are very complex projects, so, you know, things will not happen overnight, but...
Sit down to make a building. Tell me very honestly, do you look at delivering a good product or do you look at ki ye proposal mein paisa hai ki nahi, margin hai ki nahi?
Honestly, we'd be lying.
Do you look at, I'll make such a building where the product is amazing, the consumer is delighted, or do you look at whether I am making money or no?
Our approach would probably be, let's make a superior product, something that would appeal to the customers. Give them something that they would probably not get elsewhere, and then...
1 minute.
First, if there's no money, I'll not sign the deal. Product will come second. I mean, it's the first. If I'm not able to justify my own P&L, then I don't know how I'll deliver a product to the customer. The first thing is you check the P&L. It's good, you sign the deal, then you work towards the product. So I think both are important, but it just happens...
I go, a lot of developers say that times are difficult today. I mean, the government is not supportive, the land premiums are going up, the fungible deficit, XYZ, everything is going up. Are you happy being in the construction industry?
I think I don't have a
because
choice.
Because I ask a lot.
I think you have a second generation out there. I think you should ask this question to him.
First thing my dad says...
How many years have you been in business?
Four years.
Okay. The last 4 years have been very, very, can I say, entertaining, exciting, challenging, disruptive.
So you have two second generations.
Is there, Mike, interesting for somebody to take up a full-time profession and say that, yes, you know, I can still, you know, satisfy the state norms, I can still do a good work and have 15-20% margins before my account becomes NPA. Well, this is the perception of the consumers. So we want to know whether Indian developers between the two, I'm not doing it. मैं आपका साइड ले रहा हूँ. आपको भी फ्री रन है. आप बताइए आपके दुख क्या है. कंज्यूमर्स को बताइए कि व्हाट आर द चैलेंजेस फॉर अ डेवलपर टू ऑपरेट इन 2018-19.
Should I speak?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I don't think we worked at the same margins 4 years ago. I think the margins have significantly taken a hit. I think that real estate models are dependent on escalations of pricing, but there's really no escalation in pricings. So I think the pricings have been reasonably flat in the last 3 years. In fact, I think in some cases there is literally, we liquidate the stock as it's the debt stock, it's the bad stock, it's the non-vastu stock, or XYZ, blah, blah, blah. So I think for the next 5 years, it's more like an FMCG business where people are looking at consolidating the business, acquiring more market share, building systems, building the brand. And once there will be consolidation in the market, I think that be standing after 5 years and not being an NPA, then I think it's a good business to be. But if you're looking at making money today, I don't think it's a good business to be in.
Yeah, you said that, but there was some lack of energy in that. So, but I'll still take it for face value. Go ahead, let me quickly come on to you. Where do you see price? They keep asking us, I am buying this at 75 lakh rupees. थोड़ा और कम हो सकता है क्या, थोड़ा और कम हो सकता है क्या? डू यू सी प्राइजेस गोइंग डाउन फ्रॉम हियर और प्राइजेस गोइंग अप और स्टेबलाइजिंग फॉर द नेक्स्ट वन ईयर और सो?
इट वुड बी वेरी अनरियल.
यू आर नॉट सेलिंग साई स्टेट कंसल्टेंट्स फ्लैग. वी आर नॉट हियर टू सेल एनीथिंग. प्लीज स्पीक योर हार्ट आउट.
As a part of Sai, I would always love to believe that prices could go lower, because that would just make our job a lot easier.
Yeah, but do you see prices going up or down?
I honestly don't see them going down any further. We are working on across the regions that we are working on. I think we've gotten them to a point where it is absolutely break even, so to speak,
right,
for anybody to sustain any further discounting.
Right.
As
do you want to go
up? Obviously up. Why would I want it to go down?
You want prices to go up?
Yeah.
But then as consumers, 99.6% of the market is comprises of consumers. And consumers want saste ghar, kam damo mein ghar. That's what the government is saying. That's what the chief minister.
Yeah, but your price per square foot you might try to get your price per square foot up and your price realization up, but that's why people are building smaller and smaller unit sizes to make the ticket size affordable for consumers.
What do you think whether prices in the next 1 year, Indian real estate as pan India will...
I feel I'm not, I'll say about the South, not so equipped to comment on the West or North.
Okay.
I think that it's probably bottomed out. I think from here on, I feel you can expect a 3 to 4% escalation per year. But I'm not seeing something substantial. But I think movement of, if you're on a 5,000 rupee, 150 to 250 rupee bump every year.
So you see prices going up?
Yeah, rationally.
Is there real enough absorption happening in Bangalore? Since we're discussing Bangalore, are people purchasing flats?
I think that...
Are end users purchasing flats?
Yeah, I think there's reasonable sales in Bangalore. I don't think Bangalore is selling. Everybody is selling. I think that consolidation is happening where people are realizing that if you're delivering a good product, you have a good brand, you have a good thing to offer, the customer will buy. If you don't have, means you will not be a seller. But selectively, I think Bangalore is doing a reasonable amount. I think the numbers of all the listed in more than 5 crores.
Yeah.
So I think which is a good sign to show where the industry is actually moving.
What do you think, sir? Do you feel prices will go up or down?
I definitely feel prices should go up. And to get back to one question that you, I think Nirupa was answering, you asked us if we wanted, we also the cost of construction has considerably gone up over the past couple of years, whereas the same price revision has not been seen in land prices or our selling prices.
Right.
So which is why when we offer discounts all.
So what happened between 1995 to 2015 when cost of construction was also low, land premiums were also low? So why?
Yeah, definitely. I agree. Yeah, that would be the blatant truth, yes.
You enjoyed it at that point in time for 20 years?
Depends if you're existing 20 years ago.
It's been cyclical, no? It's been cyclical. It's not been
okay, so
a nice run for so long.
Is if the industry has seen a bull, from a consumer standpoint, we'll come to that and we can debate. Sir, do you, from a bird's eye view, do you want prices to go up or down? How will it influence your business of home automation and technology? If it goes down, will
your business depend on more? So if that's a function of prices going down, so be it.
Uh-huh.
That would be my view.
How about you, sir?
No, I think it will keep normalizing it. Some people will reduce the prices, some will increase the prices to make sure that their inventories are going in every industry. To see from my industry perspective, previously we had seen a 20-30% salary increments. This year we had also seen 1%, 0.7% salary increments as well. So every industry goes through ups and downs and it normalizes. That's what we'll see in real estate industry as well.
No, I was just saying it hasn't been a 20-year bull run. There have been cycles. I would feel like every 8 years you will see a cycle. So it hasn't been a 20-year bull run. And generally these, every time you go through sustained pain for 2 years, 3 years, there is consolidation that happens in the market. So there are more developers coming into the market and not exiting the market.
So since we are discussing, so we'll come back to prices because I see a lot of discomfort in discussing prices and margins at this point in time amongst the panelists and everybody present here. So we'll come back to technology. I feel Bangalore is some other city where people don't know about technology. But I see a lot of these startup companies offering lead gen, CRM services, but all those companies do not end up succeeding and seeing the light of the day. I see this starting. Why, if there is so much of appetite, if there is so much of business that is lying there, then why do these firms don't end up doing so well? If I can speak to you, and if I can tell you about two large lead generation companies, then Housing.com and, you know, XYZ was not able to, in fact, large players are not able to. So, what goes wrong?
I think maybe they spent too much of their money on marketing themselves rather than on their back-end technology. They should have been focusing on marketing on billboards and magazines. And
which company are you talking about?
No one in particular. The ones you were referring to, the ones that failed.
Okay. With the one that went underwater. Let us call it this way. Okay.
See, from digital perspective, digital or internet is a disintermediates. Digital as a village. Normally, you will require one Kirana shop in a village. And if you see Google's market share and Facebook market share, both of these together will be around 65-70%. So you don't get three or four players in any industry doing the same thing. That is what exactly we have seen in every industry. And rest of the players will be in the niche section. Niche will always survive, but general, you will always see one or two surviving. That is the trend in digital. That will always be the trend in digital.
So do you feel that the large companies, so we look at, you mentioned, but the top line of, if you guys really feel digital marketing is the next big thing, the top line of 99 acres of Magic Bricks is less than 200 crores. After having a digital footprint across the country, the top line is only 100-200 crores. But versus that, if you look at the where do you see, let me ask you a very straight question. Do you feel that the real estate industry is ready to accept digital transformation and say no to OOH or say no to newspapers?
See, it's not about whether the real estate wants digital. India is adding 70% percentage in the overall digital spend. Every industry has its own differentiation in terms of spend. And last year, 2017, April was the first time when in US digital superseded TV spend. In India, we don't see that happening. Everything is going to be that of a digital media. So wherever there is a trust, you will spend more. And digital, I don't see digital as, you know, another platform. You need to see digital to be there in mix of everything. Okay, so you need to be a marketing company rather than a digital marketing company. If you see digital marketing.
There's an opening speech, even Sapna spoke about it, RERA, GST, demonetization. Has it affected your business in any way?
It did. I mean, our target customers are real estate companies. And
because I remember a lot of developers who are not able to repay their, keep saying, RERA, GST, demonetization killed our business.
There was a temporary glitch, but it's back to normal now. In fact, you know, we have been working with developers for the last 10 years. And one lesson we have is that you cannot rush things into it. I mean, it has to be a slow and steady. And you have to make yourself relevant for their business and for their business processes.
So, has anything changed because of these three things?
So I think that GST didn't have much impact in Bangalore because I think here the cost was always 10 to 12%. Whereas, as you say, when you go to Pune and Bombay, the major impact where the price corrections or the ticket sizes went up.
Right.
Here, with service tax and a combination of VAT, it was always 10 to 11%. And today also with GST, it ends up at around 11.5 to 12%. So
right.
I don't think GST has an impact. With respect to RERA, I feel that...
What is your opinion of the Karnataka regulator? Because there is a criticism that the original law is not adapted in many states. They have been diluted. So do you see in Karnataka, how do you see the regulator?
Later on the whole have been a little sensible. I don't think that they have really done something off. They have not been so stringent because they've been practical with the times, they've been practical with the modes of financing existing in the industry, they've been practical about that. This is what Maharashtra region or Bombay region, I think they've been very stringent on the inflow of the capital. So I think that only makes it more difficult for the capital to come in. I think the significant difference being that the interest cost is considered as a project cost versus in Karnataka, in Maharashtra, I think the interest cost is capital. I think that's probably the main difference in RERA.
Right. Has anything changed for you?
Yeah, definitely, because obviously with the rules that RERA brings along, the fungibility.
Do you see a resistance across all vendors to pay GST? Of enforcing it?
Absolutely. Because otherwise we get penalized for it. With regards to RERA, there's definitely a liquidity crunch, right? So the fungibility of cash is just not there. We are heavy. We do a lot of asset heavy. Previously, you could move funds from residential business to your other verticals, which now that doesn't exist. So each vertical has to stand on its own 2 feet. So there's a lot of cash crunch from that perspective. So
what kind of cash are you talking about?
Real cash, hard cash. what are the only one kind of cash?
Yeah. So somebody from the audience said, how has demonetization affected your business? One of the developers said, if there is any cash in the room also, please tell me where is it, because I haven't seen bundles of cash in the last 1 year or so. So has the RERA GST demonetization impacted your business in any way? Because a lot of
first few months when they were implemented.
Yeah.
But over the past couple of years after they have been, I don't think there's much of a change. Primarily Bangalore being an organized market, the sales are still steady.
Right.
The market is optimistic. The developers are optimistic as well.
Right. So how about your business?
See, from our business perspective, because we have multiple other industries. So
when you provide services,
like
when we used to provide services to developers, very honestly, they used to do the 60, 40, 70, 30 business. It is no longer happening in my business. You're also a partner in one of the projects in Mumbai, right? So you would know what I'm saying. So I'm sure when you provide services, they would also used to pay you in cash and check earlier, whether you agree or no, right? So, but now has anything changed for you?
They never ask us to specially customize it for Kaccha and Pakka.
Right.
So previously,
so you used to customize it for Kaccha Pakka earlier.
So that was the request that used to come.
That is fantastic. So our pan, this is something which the audience would love to hear. I'm told in certain states there is 70-30. The 70 is not the 70 that you are thinking of, even today.
Right. Since we have multiple industries, demonetization or any change, what I have seen is suddenly all the promotion, let's wait for a few weeks to see what everyone else is doing, then we will do it.
Right.
And that's been a more of a panic rather than a real thing. Of course, in demonetization,
so your sales has gone up or down after RERA GST demonetization.
So we had and there was no certification for almost 1.5 months, and nobody knew what to do.
Right.
And we had billboards as well available, and we had to take all the advertisement from the billboard as well, because we didn't know what to do on that front.
Right.
And I wanted 3-4 panelists to come together and talk about HERA, but between the developers in themselves, they had a lot of confusion that what we can say, what we can't say, and these kind of confusion, and also the period when it is implemented sometimes happens to be a very important period for real estate people rather than a dull period. time to come out of it. And I don't think it's a fair thing on businesses.
So let me do the balancing act. Rohit, tell us that, you know, when we say about black money or cash in the system and the real estate industry, builders used to ask for it. White collar jobs still come and tell you, I'll give you 80% in check and 20% in cash. How does a developer who's starved for sales, okay, deal with such kind of, do you see such requests coming in?
It's,
tell us the truth.
It's very, very unconventional. It's more of consumer driven and not so much a request that a developer puts forth or and, a mandate that a developer
I would tell
puts
you
forth.
That most Indian developers today don't want to deal with cash.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
They actually want 100%. But what I sold one apartment in on, you know, somewhere on the outskirts of the city, and I have received this bundle of cash and this is the check that I have. I will only buy an apartment when you give me a mix of match of, you know, the black and white.
So it's a continuation of the medium in which the initial back in the day was
because a lot of development companies are not as regulated, are not
exactly
listed like the Bangalore market or the West Bengal market. I mean, large chunks of money still comes in Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa and different parts of the country. Do you feel that?
I don't think there is an option. To say you
no, I mean, I mean, there is a lot of transaction. I'm sure everybody is aware of. Still happens with cash and check. Do you feel that all developers via the consortium of CRIDAI or MCHI? Any cash transaction?
To be honest with you, I think my average selling price across portfolios around 5,000 to 6,000 bucks. And 99.9% of the buyers are home loan buyers. And I don't think that we have requests much.
Yeah.
Wherein sort of you've almost come to zero discounts. You just sort of take it or leave it. And you started implementing that now slowly across projects just to keep it simple.
Right. So I have the pleasure of dealing with happening. Let me get down to the audience and understand, are there any questions? We have good about 10 minutes left. Any questions for my panelist? Yes.
Not so much for the panelists, but I met up with
There's no question that you want to ask, sir? You wanted to hear more about PropTech. That's a feedback for me. Maybe in the next panel we can discuss about PropTech also. Yes, sir.
Accept the fact the government authorities will not pass your plan without taking cash. Accept the fact. And not only the planning, every section takes cash, irrespective of it being Modi or Gandhi.
That happens in Karnataka.
All over India. Forget Karnataka. All over India. I can vouch for it. As far as real estate or any trade is concerned, I can vouch for that.
That's a valid point. And next time, I would like to have you on my panel so that we can make it
public. Yeah, yeah.
See, you were talking about the lady out there was talking about the Facebook ad and the Times of India ad. An ad in Facebook, it cost me nothing. Supposing I don't get a response for anything else. I will not go back to Times of India and advertise again. I will go back in Facebook and advertise again. I may get a response. So why should I waste 10,000 bucks a second time?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
And on Facebook. I don't get a response from either. For example, I will not go back to Times and advertise and spend another 10,000, but I will go and repeat the ad in Facebook. So why should I go back to Times? Facebook is more, I may get a response again. Yeah.
I don't know, it depends on what kind of ad, depends on
no, any ad,
so
for example,
things.
I put an ad for asking for a property for yes. Outright or JD, I don't get a call.
Huh.
I put the same ad on Facebook, I get 10 calls from brokers.
So let's,
that's if, good, do what works.
If I can add a point to it, so when you put a ad targeting the people,
That's how a follow-up campaign can happen and give you double result rather than focusing on just one point. But if you're doing something, you need to know.
Yeah. But sir, Times has given zero response to date even after advertising.
So, but how do you know that it has not created the awareness? So, we call it as the last attribution problem. Giving attribution to everything contributed in the complete buyer's funnel. And that is an understanding of marketing that buyers will go from awareness to interest to consideration to sales. And the sales might happen from one channel. That does not mean awareness was not created by another
awareness
channel.
Awareness may have been created, but there's no response.
Etc. Then you can understand a little more.
I can't keep spending on Times of India every now and then. Practically speaking, I can't keep spending every week 10,000 or 20,000 bucks on Times of India just for advertising, right?
Right.
Whereas Facebook and LinkedIn are free.
Just a question. Response. Did you have a call to action in the ad? Did you say this specific number came from Facebook, which came from Times, which came from the radio? Did you? I mean, I'm just curious to know if you put a call to action.
Call to action means?
So, if you get 100 leads, I'm just saying, and you're doing multiple campaigns, whether it's radio or paper or digital, digital is easy to track.
Yeah.
But I'm...
numbers given on the ad.
So and there was zero responses.
Total zero response from Times. Total zero.
So we'll go back to Times of India, and I have a lot of friends in Times, so I'll go back and give you your feedback. Thank you. Is there anybody else who wants to ask a question? Yes, please.
So, for the real estate, for the developers, B2C, like, I mean, the end customers or the, like, target audience.
Right.
So, what I'm seeing is, like, whatever the ads, like, what I see in Facebook or, like, print media, so it's mostly on the pricing focus. Like, I mean, like, the kind of ads from the developer side. And my question for you is, like as an agency, do you think like whatever the campaign plan, like when the campaign is like when the plan is starting?
Let me summarize. What he wants to say is, I want to see some creative stuff. Don't just hit numbers at me saying 35 lakhs, 40 lakhs, 50 lakhs. Is there any creativity in your campaigns?
See, you must have seen a very creative campaign from Snapdeal, which says, the Trivago. Everyone hated the ad in Trivago, but it worked for them. The sales were going up. And on the other hand, they have burned around 200 crores on Snapdeal, and the sales did not go up. So when you do a creative campaign, the creative campaign has a purpose. So you can do a very creative campaign, which we have done multiple creative campaigns for the property brand, not for the property. If you do a creative campaign for a property, then it is no use. But if you do a creative campaign for property brand, which was done on August 15th, and that was a good campaign for the, and that there was nothing about property. That was a creative campaign where multiple stars came together and were singing a Jai Ho song, which was good campaign for them for brand building, but that will not result in sales. They knew it. And the spent on sales in this industry, and which will be very different from another industry. Will you ever buy a SIM card which you are not aware of? You will not buy. So branding is more important there compared to some other industry.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hi, we've heard cash, we've heard advertisement strategies, but none of it has been so focused on the subject, which is PropTech. Some of you being, most of you being the connoisseurs in the field, and especially young brigands like Darshan and Nirupa. So my you investing for all of us to follow.
Thank you, sir, for making my job easy.
See, when it comes to PropTech, there are multiple faces of PropTech that we need to understand. If you look at globally,
slightly less upset with me at the end of the session. Yeah, so 60 seconds.
Yeah, so there are multiple faces of PropTech. Now, there are things which are happening globally, like when you're walking, the electricity is being produced, which is funding the whole building itself. We are also thinking about how will the parking happen in the future. When autonomous cars are going to come, is the parking going to be the same? And now from autonomous car, you are talking about detached modules which will go from one place to the other and will get connected and will come and park in your places. Those things will also happen in the future. They are maybe going to WhatsApp for business, which is cheaper, cutting down the cost rather than investing on something which is going to increase the cost. So I think it is about the market where people are looking for, like Vivekananda said, religion is not for empty bellies. So if you are looking for innovation, then innovation will happen and we will get as the consumers are asking for.
Yes, well said.
Okay, so we are an out-and-out technology company and we are in the business of creating technologies to make spaces more meaningful in terms of its usage, its safety, and everything. And we are clearly seeing a trend, whether it's the... And it's supposed, you know, there is definitely a trend where buildings are becoming more responsive to your needs and they will ensure that they're easier to maintain and more safe and so on and so forth. And definitely the journey has just started. I mean, rise and fall is actually a wrong terminology because we are of homes and the offices, and like I said in the beginning as well, when today's teenagers becomes tomorrow's home buyers or you know office space buyer, they are going to look at things from a completely different perspective. So I think the journey has just started and the rise has just
at one point in our advertisement, smart homes and related to smart homes is the second best working campaign after location. So certainly the smart home related things are giving us the second best result after the location as the core communication.
Technology is a solution to some of our problems that we face every day. Now we talk about sustainability, but does everyone cares about the carbon footprint, but what's in it for them? So we got to invest in technology to provide renewable energy solutions that will probably bring down the maintenance cost of a home buyer. Want their homes quicker, at better qualities, at a better quality and more reliable. What do? You invest in a precast technology, right? You invest in an assembly line fashion of constructing all your slabs, columns, beams, etc. And have them assembled. So investment in PropTech is definitely a must in order to alleviate some of the problems that you would not be able to do traditionally otherwise.
So for me, I think PropTech is reasonably medieval. I would subdivide PropTech into three parts. One will be for the business, real estate business for the developers themselves. I would say second part of PropTech would be consumer facing. And the third part of PropTech would be the government sort of opting PropTech. From a business perspective, I think the evolution of PropTech has been fantastic, and I think it's the evolution is going on more and more. I think the ERPs are getting better and better in India, understanding the system as to what's going. It touches almost all parts of our business. It's too huge of our business. I think recent times, PropTech evolution has been more on the marketing and CRM side and construction management side. I think there have been some path-breaking things happening around there for us to sort of save costs, monitor costs, time schedules, lead captures, mobilization, selection of... To the government, I think it's been a little bit of disappointment. I feel that the processes have slowed down because I don't think they've been able to sustain the tech from an approval standpoint. Because the time it takes for them to clear the approval has become larger, the acceptance, the processes, everything. So I'm hoping that evolution happens pretty quickly, because that's really not good for the industry if the government part of tech is not support tech, which has come in India, I think has been fabulous. I think the way they have TCS has sort of operated that and they've executed and delivered is amazing. But I don't think that level of quality is coming into the tech in the government offices, wherein they've really thought through almost every variable or that amount of input. think that there will be a lot of successes, a lot of failures, because it's like any other consumer business. Technology and businesses take time. So there will be a lot of falls, there will be a lot of sort of successes. And I think it's a very nascent stage. It's ready to expand. I think that will be the most exciting space probably in the next decade or so from a tech point of view.
I have 3 points to make. The first point is my approach to technology is how can technology enhance productivity? How can you use technology to help people connect 20 million square feet or 30 million square feet? So how do you use technology for that? Could be through drones or apps to manage your sites, constructions, whatever it is. So my approach to technology is how can it help enhance productivity? Second approach to it is that I think tech companies we see are not their product or service to meet our needs. Because, and I'm saying this because on an annual basis, we meet at least 200 startups purely with real estate tech as a product or software. But we finally work with only 6 or 7 because they are the ones we want to work with. But a lot of the startups are ready with their back-end operations to deliver at the kind of pace or at the or meet our needs. So we need to work with a few of them to actually get them to that level to be able to suit our needs. And the third point I want to make is that technology, I mean, this. So everybody talks about smart, and you said smart is the second most searched term in real estate for a smart home.
It's the second most communication, which is working to generate leads.
Yes.
But it is not the second most to convert.
Exactly. Because today, if you ask me, we also have to. If it's just a nice to have and not a must have, nobody's going to pay for it, and neither the developer is going to pay for it, neither is the consumer going to pay for it. So even when we talk about smart homes, we've launched in many smart home campaigns, but the moment you put a price to it, people say, no, I don't want it. Either you include it in this rate.
Yeah. So whatever you get free as far as technology is concerned is most welcome as long as they don't increase.
So my only comment is it has to be a must have and not a nice to have for people to be willing to pay for it.
Go with your final words on this.
I look at technology uptake has been ongoing since 20, 30 years now. To me, it is a function of, if I had to really dumb it down, which we tend to do in our line of work, is a function of internet penetration. Now, adaptation to technology. When I say technology, it could mean all of those things that Darshan touched upon. Like I said, it means different things in different cities. So, something like an Aerocon brick would be technology of. A smart kitchen, or you know, self-cleaning devices, or something to that, something on those lines is more what they consider technology. So, or the addition of technology to standard practices. So these things will depending on the kind of region that we are looking at. In my opinion, obviously there is the title that we have gone with here, which is the rise and fall of PropTech, is a misnomer in my opinion. It is the rise and rise of PropTech, because as time passes, it is going to make processes and practices simpler for us. A time might come when it also has a say in the overall costing. Today we seem to think that the addition of technology may result, but a time will come when the reverse of that is true, and location agnostic, we will know that, you know, the time of technology in property has truly arrived.
Sir, can I also take 30 seconds to tell you what I feel about it? Build flats and we sell those flats to consumers. The minute they understand that there is no further price negotiation possible beyond a point. Okay, so after negotiating for 45 minutes, if they know there is no further price negotiation possible, between prop tech being an optional amenity than being what we were discussing when we started, before we started the panel, than being a standard amenity. In every apartment in India, there should be a minimum requirement. This is the technology that every apartment will.
You know, the customers approach them that remove these things and give me a better price. Those options are not given, and then actually goes with the project.
Right. So,
it was a wonderful panel. All these things are fine: prop tech, technology. Most of the time, as far as the builders are concerned, you know, we tend to take the booking amount and thereafter you don't, you know, pay real attention in terms of what needs to be done. What customer wants is, end of the day, is that they want solutions to their problems. After we sell the apartment, we don't find it. I'll give you a classic example. About a month back, in our Green Bay project, the water quality was pretty bad. In terms of how they discuss things, and people are quite knowledgeable. Everybody said we should go and meet Srini and tell him that it's not acceptable. So somehow the news came to me and I presented this to the board, engineering department.
Who's the mother-in-law in the consumer builder?
No, marketing is always a mother-in-law. We win all the time. We don't allow the engineering to win. Right. So engineering
I'm
is definitely...
I'm happy I'm a sales and a marketing guy. So I think we're quickly running out of time. There's a
just a minute, yeah, I'll
yes,
just
yes,
close
yes,
it.
Yes,
just
sir.
Sanjay, they said, Srini, have you done your homework? I presented the because I come from a very heavy research knowledge from TVWA. So I did the entire thing. They asked me end of the day because my company is all, board is entire, board is Marwadi's. They entirely, finally looked at the about a week later, we sent a letter to the entire Green Bay owners and they just came and met me. If I say that, I get only goosebumps. They came and just gave me sweets, gifts. They enjoyed an hour of music at my at the end.
The
I think
also,
something we have to provide.
Yeah, the consumers are also facing a lot of
music
these days. But we'll discuss that on a different panel. We just have time for one question, maybe one more after this.
Hi, my name is Charudit from Night Frank. My question is to... contributing for Brigade's prosperity or success. Can you please share your experience? Thank you.
Thanks. So actually, I'm not a venture capitalist at all. What we do is we meet almost 200 technology companies in a year. And we tweak their business model. And only then, if we think that there's scalability in that startup or tech firm, do we further invest in them? So it's a very considered call. It's not just putting in money in startups. We would have access to 100 technology real estate firms in the next 5 years. So that is the goal.
So
and we want to use it, like I said, it either has to enhance our productivity or increase our revenue. And these are the only two main ways. So either like you find technology to improve your company's productivity and operational efficiency. That's the only two criteria we look at.
I think we completely ran out of time. Yeah. Is there any more questions? Okay. Last one. One there. Okay. Tripti, can I?
Facebook. I think I should respond that Facebook posts are free of cost, but not Facebook ads.
Great.
And depending
on
there's so much money
that we are paying Facebook. Rohit, do a show of hands. So much money you're spending on Insta, Facebook, everywhere. Google, SEO, SEM.
The other question is with regards to the trend. I think today's trend is that people are looking out for wonderful facilities as well as clubhouses within the vicinity.
Right.
My question is that are there people looking out for professionals who can manage the show also?
Yeah, so he's asking.
agencies to manage clubhouses. Is that what you're asking?
That's correct. And are the people looking out for?
Yeah, of course. I mean, to say if you're building a large clubhouse, you'll need a good hospitality agency like any other hotel to manage it. So obviously, they're looking out for someone.
I'm actually one.
Okay, so myself and get enough mileage out of a panel. Of course, everything is sponsored here.
You can send us your contact information.
Hello, my name is Ankur. The question is for Nirupa. So basically, from the morning, we have been listening to a lot of panel discussions and people have been talking about disruption in the industry. So, you know, technologies around...
Has Brigade planted a few people in the audience? That's...
Okay.
Kidding.
Yeah, so, but somebody will have to take the initiative and, you know, do certain things, like, you know, talking about property management. That's one of the key concerns for all the people. We have been talking about the ground as of now, and what are the plans that you have in the future for this kind of, you know, adoption of technology when it comes to these things?
Okay, thanks for the question. So, I just one correction. I didn't say we were not willing to pay. I said it should, whatever technology we use should give up. Not going to come cheap to us, but we think it will enhance the overall customer experience. Okay, so then we are willing to pay for that. We have worked with at least two startups on the smart parking on smart parking systems. So, for instance, there is one company called PeeParkey that we met you. What is the efficiency of each parking bay by just putting sensors, no wires, no anything. So that is on the smart parking bit. Then we are working with, say, STP plants. So we're working with company, there's a company called EcoSTP that finds ways to create STP. We're working with a water management company. So they'll put sensors through all the pipes to see how much water is being used by each apartment. So I think in Whitefield especially, there's a huge water crisis. So then a lot of the residential towers there want to know so that way people will start getting more conscious about how much water each apartment consumes because you pay only per what you use. Same for gas, same for electricity, same for everything. So just like how electricity is metered, your water will start getting metered, your gas will start getting metered. So we are working in a year. And then we are not keeping this technology to ourselves. We actually introduce them to 100 other developers by helping them pitch at, say, a CREDAI conference. So we get the support of CREDAI for that. So the idea is not to hoard the developers. But we like the idea. We want to work with startups. We want to use technology to enhance our own operational efficiency.
Super. Well said. One last question here.
I have a question for Nirupa. It's basically a question for everybody. It's like we have a good set of people, of agents and developers and even the supporting companies. See, developer, we want more money. But nobody has spoken that how the technology will help you to reduce the pricing. Because, see, as a developer, okay, first of all, I would like to tell you about myself. I'm Ankit. I'm a former luxury head for Prestige Group. And I had this because I have been heading a lot of verticals around for the ratio, the margin is secondary for us. We are using all the technology from paper ads to a digital marketing to publish our company, a brand, a project to at the end to get a sale. Even for our channel partners, they are also doing the same thing by putting a pamphlet and newspaper. At the end of the day, reducing pricing,
how do you reduce
it will sort out everything.
Technology? That's a very interesting question.
Yeah.
I'm actually jealous I didn't think of it and didn't ask you that.
So my question to you is, see, there are a lot of these B2C companies, like you said, Magic Breaks, Common Floor, all that, but your cost per lead should be reducing, right? So obviously, we all have our lead to walk-in to conversion ratios. So I would say that from digital, so you'll have to go with a company. I think there was some question on which are the digital companies that are so-called surviving, right? The companies that are surviving are the ones that give you business in the end. And there are many digital companies that help you reduce your cost per lead and where the ratio to the conversion ratio is higher. Those are the ones that will do well and those are the ones that will survive. From a cost perspective, what I was saying before, like for instance, the way you can reduce your cost the various companies trying. Today I'm saying that developers ready to pay for a solution that will help reduce their cost. But like I said, the startups are not there to provide the right solution that will help you just yet. There are a lot of energy management companies that will say, okay, I'll reduce your energy consumption by 10% to help us get there. And I was also saying we're using, for instance, drones to see if I have one person managing, like one, say a CEO managing 10 million square feet, can I increase his capacity by using drones to manage maybe 10 projects to Malleshwaram to North Bangalore is just not possible. So there are many ways to look at this cost aspect of it. Reducing cost could come from increasing your top line or increasing the price you're able to charge for a particular product. So why are we talking about smart homes and using Alexa and I reduce my cost or how do I increase the price I'm able to get. So there are so many ways to do it. There's no easy solution, but we are working with these companies to see how we can do that, either CapEx or OpEx or whatever it is.
To get prices down is never an easy
technology to correct my pricing. Yeah, so the thing is that technology is only going to get you, so it can get you some savings. I don't think that savings are substantial enough to sort of have a price drop. You can build more efficiency from technology, but again, it will not get you a price drop. Technology is only going to add to your price. So if somebody is marketing Alexa and he has to sort of go through, so today I make cost, or my cost per switch is X, my cost per switch will go Y. The moment I sort of have to integrate technology to the switch, plus also I think to 5 rupees a square feet of maintenance. Now, every time if I've upgraded the technology of the house, every time the fluctuations in the electricity in India is quite, you know, the stuff, and they have to keep on changing the switches and panels and stuff like that. Alexa, switch on the lights, Alexa, switch on the geysers, Alexa, switch on the thing. But your cycle cost will also increase to a certain extent. So are a consumer ready for even a higher sort of outflow on a monthly basis on account of technology? Cost for us has already gone up. I think it will probably rationalize back to what it used to be. I think 5% customer acquisition cost on sale is a myth now. I don't think it's happening in 5% at all. I think people realize it by the project ends. So I think I'm hoping technology.
If you guys have not, where guys, you've been seated there for 96 minutes. So please give an applause to my 6 panelists who've been coping up with me and, you know, from the audiences. Today. Thank you so much for being there and thank you so much for attending the Realty Plus Conclave. See you next time.
Once again, could we have a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, to our esteemed folks. And I'd like to invite Mr. N.A. Dayan. Louder on the applause. I think this was an awesome discussion.
I changed my mind.